Thank you, Bala, for those very generous words of introduction, and thank you all for being here this evening to be able to listen to my story. So the way I wanted to actually do it was kind of capture it in three discrete capsules, one of which was about my stint at Titan, the second is about my stint at Reliance Retail, and the third I will cover about the work that I'm currently doing, which is a mix of what I used to do at both Titan and at Reliance Retail, and then some stargazing into the future. So I kind of titled this as what am I defined as? You can shape your destiny, because I figured out that all of you all are next gen retailers, and given that you're a next gen retailer, one of the most important things to remember is that you don't have to let the circumstances influence you. You can yourself influence the circumstances, which is why I said you could shape your destiny. So if you really look at it, the first part of what I wanted to cover is the Titan story. And to just give you a brief synopsis of the Titan story, started in 1987. When we started off at that stage saying that we want to set up a business to be able to manufacture and sell quartz watches in India. A lot of people laughed at us because they said that why are you making and selling quartz watches? Because if you look at the market is 90% mechanical watches, dominated by HMT and Allred. And quartz was a very small segment, mostly serviced by smugglers who were bringing in sub-smuggled Seiko and Citizen watches. So they said that what's a big deal in putting up a watch market at that time, which is about 10 million. 1 million is the size of the quartz segment, and you're putting up a plant to make 2.5 million watches. But the conviction that we had at Titan was that if you look at the world around us is 80% quartz and 20% mechanical. Mechanical watches are mostly made by the Swiss at the very top end of the market in terms of pricing, whereas the larger segment, which was servicing the middle class, serviced by the Japanese brands like Citizen, Seiko and Casio, were quartz watches across the country, across the world. So we said that's the trend across the world. Why should we be left behind? Let's put up a plant only to make quartz watches and put up 2.5 million in a market of quartz which is only 1 million and a total watch market of 10 million. When we started first with the watch business, and in the watch business we first started with Titan as a brand. So we established Titan as a brand, and we felt that we needed a brand which had the name of the company, and that's how we established Titan as a brand. Then the second part of it is that as we went along, and that is in 1987, as we went along in 1991, we had an opportunity to be able to actually partner with an American brand. So one of the challenges that we had with Titan was in collaboration for the manufacturer movements with a French company, and it was an all-metal movement, and being an all-metal movement and being a European-based movement, it's a bit more expensive to manufacture. Consequently, the watches were priced in those days 365 rupees and above. So we felt that there was a larger segment which was below the 365 rupees, primarily catered to by the mechanical watches serviced made by HMT. So we said we must also then try and figure out how to enter that part of the market and do it profitably. And that is how we partnered then with an American company called Timex. And that partnership lasted from 92 to about 98, and then after that we had to part ways for various reasons. At the same point of time when we parted ways with Timex, we felt that there was an opportunity to address two parts of the market. One part was in the market that Timex was addressing, and since the JV had been split in 98, we said that we need to address that part of the market, and to that extent a new brand was launched, which was called Sonata. And Sonata was launched saying that while Titan was a parent brand by itself, Sonata came in as a brand saying Sonata from Tata. So what you can see here is a subtle difference in terms of branding between Titan being a singular brand and Sonata being a brand supported by Tata. Because when we did a lot of research, especially in the smaller towns, what we did discover is that Tata as a brand name has got greater salience in small cities and in the villages than Titan also. And hence we said, if you're going in the small towns and villages, let's try and use Tata as a brand name. So that's how Sonata was born. Then, as we went along, and that was again way back in 1999, we did discover that, Titan was around for about 12 years by then, 87 to 99. And a lot of people used to buy Titan. So many people had 2, 3, 4 Titan watches. And then they were getting a bit fed up in terms of why should I buy a Titan watch. And the second part of it is that there's a whole new generation of customers who are coming in. And that new generation of customers who are coming in were saying that, you know, Titan's for my parents, for my father and for my mother, but what is there for me? I want something which is a little more fashionable, which is younger. And so we decided to build a new brand which is for the youth. And that's how Fast Track was born as a watch brand. And then of course, as we went along, we discovered that, you know, women found that the men, the watches that they were wearing were primarily men's watches in smaller sizes. So they said that, you know, if you look at what we wear bangles and we wear various, you know, decorative pieces of jewelry on our hands. And when we look at what we are wearing on the watch is the most plain thing that we have on our wrist. So can't we get watches which will actually complement the jewelry that we wear? And that's how then we brought out another brand, which is not really a brand, it is a range, which is called Raga from Titan. And Raga was born with the thing that we must try and get women watches which they will feel proud of wearing, along with the jewelry that they wear on their hands, rather than giving them smaller size men's watches. At a later stage, what did come about was that we started in simultaneously a jewelry business, and I'll cover that in a little more detail later. But when we were doing the jewelry business, which is making, you know, lots of gold products, we said that one of the things that we did see in the market was amongst jewelers, a lot of people used to buy regular watches and then go to the jeweler and get a 18 karat gold bracelet put onto a regular watch. The classic one was something called the Rado Diastar. And the Rado Diastar they buy a Rado watch, remove its bracelet, get a gold bracelet put onto it. So in a lot of places, especially Andhra and Tamil Nadu, you'd see these flashy gold bracelets and Rado Diastar watches that a lot of men used to wear. We said that, you know, obviously there is a need. People are looking for something which is a little more precious, especially men. And one of the things we realized that for the man, the only piece of jewelry that the man really has is a watch. You know, barring that they might have a chain, they might have a few rings. But beyond that, the only thing that they can actually flaunt in terms of, you know, look value is a watch. So we said that, is there a way in which you can actually make, you know, watches which are precious in terms of value, and then also make sure that, you know, it looks good. So it shouldn't be like the Rado Diastar, where the watch and the bracelet are looking quite independent of each other. So we created gold watches, where it's a gold case and a gold bracelet, but well integrated in terms of design. And that's how the nebular range of Titan was born. Then there are two others that you can see. One of them was actually a technological marvel, a range called the Titan Edge, which is in the top left. Titan Edge is actually the slimmest movement we made in the world. At that point in time, even till today, continues to remain the slimmest movement in the world, which is a movement which is 3.15 millimeters thick. So really speaking, when you look at the thickness of the movement is actually just about marginally thicker than a credit card. So when we took that movement, then we had to build a battery around it, which will also be very slim. Then we had to make a case around it, which will also be very slim. One of the challenges that we had when we made very slim cases was that when you strap the watch onto your wrist, the glass used to pop out because the case was so thin and there's very little metal on the side to hold the glass. So we had to do a lot of complicated engineering in order to make sure that we actually had a working slim watch rather than just a museum piece. So we then launched what is called the Titan Edge, which is continues to be the slimmest watch in the world. And then we had the other thing that we noticed was from 1998 onwards, the government allowed the import of watches. So well before many other consumer products came into the market to import, one of the first categories, largely because of this pressure on Mr. Kamal Nath, who was at that time Commerce Minister, we ended up having watches being allowed into the country under OGL in 1998. Some of you all might remember what OGL is. And then what happened after that was that we had to go back to the government and say that, you know, you are allowing complete watches to be imported in this country, whereas on the other hand, you don't even allow parts of watches to be imported. So how come you're allowing this to happen, but you're not allowing parts to be imported? Of course, things changed over time, and they allowed parts to be imported. But the point was that at that point in time, a lot of Swiss watches came into the market. And when Swiss watches came into the market, we felt that there was a need for us to be able to actually create a Swiss-made watch. And we then brought out a Swiss-made watch, a watch which is completely designed, assembled, manufactured in Switzerland, which is called the Zeiss range from Titan. So what you can see here is that over time, while we started with Titan in the beginning as a single brand, but over time we began to understand different customer segments. And as we began to understand different customer segments and the need to be able to address them, the challenge was to address them with the parent brand or to address them with another brand. And then we said that if you, and there are pros and cons with each. Because we address them with the parent brand, then of course the great advantage we have is the equity that the parent brand has. On the other hand, if you were to address them with a new brand, then you have to be able to create a very distinct imagery for the new brand, but then that takes time and money. So obviously there's an investment you have to make and it takes scale. And then, you know, in that process you will also burn some cash. So it's a very strategic decision. And I think a lot of us actually, when we look at it, will end up having to figure out, should I address my business with only one brand, or should I develop several brands around it? Should I do a mother brand strategy where I can do, so say, a Sony Bravia, then I can do a Sony, another brand, etc., etc. So that's one option which is available. Or I can do a Hindustan Lever kind of strategy, where I can do a Lux, I can do a Rexona, I can do a Duck. All of which independent brands are there. The only thing in the back is that made by Hindustan Lever. So, you know, these are two very, very different approaches. And given the context of the market, the size of the opportunity, the ambition you have, the ability that you have to be able to invest and grow these brands, the luxury of time that you will have to be able to absorb losses, all of these are very, very critical decisions that you will then have to take in order to figure out whether you can do a single brand or you can do multiple brands. So this is just to give you a brief summary of the watch story. And I know we have to run tight, so that's why I'm going a bit fast. Way back in 1992, when we used to export watches to Europe, one of the things that we realized in Europe was that a lot of watches used to be sold by jewelers. So unlike India, where watches are sold by watch stores, there the number of watch stores were limited, but there were lots more jewelers who used to sell watches. And in the course of actually trying to sell Titan watches to jewelers in Europe, one of the things that we discovered was that a lot of the jewelers said that we actually also require jewelry. So one of the businesses that we decided to venture in 92 was to actually say, can we make jewelry and supply jewelry to retailers of jewelry in Europe? And we started the business. We ran it for about a couple of years, because it just was a month's business. It just didn't make sense, because you were actually making jewelry for retail. And when I say retail, you're making jewelry to actually sell to a retailer who was keeping it in his shop or her shop, and then selling it to customers. There was no scale, first of all. There was no uniformity in terms of design. So you never could build scale in terms of product. Thirdly, the quantity was so low, and the cost of servicing that order was so high. So at the end of it, after 2 years and burning a lot of cash, he said that this business doesn't make sense. What we really gained in the course of 2 years is an understanding of European designs. Because a lot of the businesses were actually about designing European jewelry for European jewelry retailers. Having then understood European designs, we said, can we then make this a business for India? So from 95 to 98, we actually tried to sell European design jewelry in India under the Tanishq brand name. And then we discovered that that also really didn't gain traction. First year we did some 26 crores, second year I think we did some 70 crores, the third year I remember we did 125 crores, the fourth year we did about 180 crores, and yet we were losing cash. In the course of 4 years, by the time we reached 180 crores, we had lost 100 crores in terms of bottom line. So we realized that that also wasn't gaining traction. And in that 4 years, we kind of tried to understand what are some of the challenges. And when we looked at the challenges, we realized that while we were able to create a new paradigm in terms of watches in a mechanically dominated Indian watch market, because people were actually looking forward to it. But on the other hand, when you looked at the jewelry market being such a large market, people are actually very, very happy with traditional Indian designs. So they said, give us traditional Indian designs, which meant make jewelry in 22 carat, make jewelry which is Indian in terms of design, and then make it available to us. So then we said, if we are doing that, then and everybody else is doing the same thing, what is the differentiator? Then what is the reason why somebody should come in and buy the Tanishq brand? So we again researched the market. And when we researched the market, one of the biggest things that we discovered in the market was that there was a huge trust deficit. And people, while they trusted the jeweler when they bought jewelry, weren't confident that the jewelry that they bought was actually the category that was proposed, that was sold to them. So then when we looked at you know, samples across the country, and I remember that MP was one of those places where the variation between what is promised and what is actually delivered is most significant. Tamil Nadu was that way much better. So while they were saying 22 in MP, most of the average they were getting 16. Whereas in Tamil Nadu and Calcutta, while they were saying 22, it was between 20 and 21. So the variation wasn't that much. So we said that, you know, this could be one way in which we can, you know, try and address opportunity in the marketplace. So we imported some equipment from Germany, understood how we could actually measure purity at the retail level using these machines. Then ran a scheme where we said that come in and test your jewelry, check out whatever is the purity of your jewelry, and then you can exchange that against jewelry of equivalent character. The whole point here was to be able to get customers to come to the store and test their jewelry. And when we got them to come in and test their jewelry, a lot of the customers discovered that they actually had bought or were sold jewelry which is considerably lower than the promised category. So that created a lot of dissonance amongst customers with their existing jewelers, created a lot of social talk about the fact that, you know, I bought jewelry from X jeweler and I went to the Tanish store and checked it out and I found it. But by default, it created a trust value in Tanish. And in the context of having created a trust value in Tanish, Tanish managed to appropriate the fact that I am a trusted jeweler. So the jewelry business largely started from the fact that, you know, we managed to, it wasn't a simple business. Unlike the watch business, then the day we started, we actually began seeing profit. In the case of jewelry, we went through 6 years of ups and downs and various forms of strategy before we actually even began to see a break-even level. So today, while it's a very large business, extremely profitable, it took a long while, 6 years and almost 100 crores of cash, before we discovered that it was going to be the right business model. So when we looked at jewelry, we again had the same challenges as in the case of Catterton. Multiple brands had to be made because we were looking at different customer segments. There were working women, there were occasions like weddings, there were religious occasions like people had to buy jewelry, there were where people wanted to buy only diamond jewelry, people who wanted to buy only plain gold jewelry. So looking at different wear occasions and different buying occasions, we then had to figure out whether there existed opportunities to be able to build separate brands across these various reasons. So that's the reason how we managed to bring in Zoya for the upper end, Tanish, which is largely focused on the upper middle class. We had another brand which used to be in retail called Gold Plus, which is on the top left. And as you can see, like we use the Tata brand name for Sonata, similarly we use the Tata brand name also for Gold Plus, because Gold Plus was again a retail format which is targeted mostly at the smaller towns. Mia again for the working woman. And similarly, like that, we offer various occasions. So what you can see here, while there will be a single category, which is jewelry, but here, based on customer segments and occasions, you're actually being able to create new brands, just like the way you did in the case of the watch business. Then, having done both these businesses, one of the things that we realized was, when we were doing fast-track watches, there seemed to be an opportunity for us to be able to build a much larger brand around fast-track. So while it was a very strong, powerful youth brand, it was largely watches. So we said, is there a way in which we can extend it beyond watches? So one of the first categories that we got into at that stage was to be able to get into sunglasses. Because youth were wearing watches, youth were also wearing sunglasses. And sunglasses for them was as much a fashion statement as the watches that they were wearing. And hence we got into the sunglass business. So Fast Track sunglasses came in. Then after Fast Track sunglasses came in, we realized that a much larger part of the eyewear market is actually not sunglasses, but prescription eyewear. And then when prescription eyewear was evaluated in a little more detail, we said that can we take the same retailing capabilities that we have in the case of Tanish, which is jewelry, can we take some of the design capabilities that we have, which is in the case of watches and jewelry, and can we take some of the same customer orientation that we built over time and build it out into another business, and that's how the eyewear business is built. And there, as you can see, is again, you know, part of it is Fast Track, which is the sunglass business. Then, of course, you have prescription eyewear, which is again there. And this came under the Titan Eyeglass business, in addition to Fast Track sunglasses. Then I mentioned to you about the fact that in 1998, the government allowed us to import complete watches. And then when, you know, domestic companies went to make some noise, the government said, yeah, you can also start importing parts of watches. So you could actually import bracelets and cases and stuff like that. So we did an evaluation of whether it made sense for us to make a buy. And we discovered that, you know, China was building scale in certain parts of watches. And we said that there are things that we could actually buy out of China, like bracelets, etc., which could be cheaper made in China and paid custom duty and brought into this country, rather than actually making it to the scale that we were making it in India. Sometimes the capability didn't exist in India, or sometimes if the capability existed, the cost was too high. So after evaluating a complete make-buy decision on what we should make and what we should buy, then we realized that there are certain parts of our factory in terms of manufacturing assets which would get redundant. And then we evaluated that and we realized that one of the key skills that we have is in terms of precision engineering. Because every part in the watch that you make is actually made to micron precisions. And it's got to be made accurately, consistently, because you can't have one wheel which is slightly different from another wheel, because otherwise the watch will not work. So it was, you know, you're making parts at micron precision consistently in scale. So we said if we take that whole capability that you have of making parts at micron precision and in scale, which are the other industries that you could actually look at addressing? And the first industry that we went to was the automobile industry. The second industry that we went to was actually the aircraft industry. So when we went to the automobile industry and then we looked at what we could do, of course there were people who were making forged cast parts and things like that. That didn't seem to make sense for us because that was scale and didn't have precision. But then there were parts like, for example, the fuel injector. So the fuel injector and the fuel injection pump. Well, the pump itself is a cast casing. There's a fuel injector inside, which is very, very high precision holds, because that's got to spray the exact percentage, exact proportion of fuel into the cylinder at each stroke. So then we started making fuel injectors, and like that we made several precision parts of the automobile industry, extended that to also making cockpit parts for the airline, started making some of the connectors for the wings, so we were supplied to Airbus and various others. But what happened in this precision engineering business is that born out of the manufacturing capability that you had and figuring out that some of these assets were actually redundant, is there a way in which we can create greater value addition for these manufacturing assets and then using that skill that you have to be able to extend to other businesses, as opposed to the other option that we had at that stage was to sell this as machinery. And if you sold it as machinery, you would have probably got maybe 20% of book value. But then on the other hand, if you manage to convert that from this machines and then add to it capability and build something out of it from not maybe the watch industry, but think outside the watch industry, then there was an opportunity. Today that's a 400 crore business, which is actually quite profitable. So that's the other part of this business. The other aspect that we looked at watches, what we realized is that, you know, in watches, the whole role of watch as a timekeeping device tells you time was actually declining over time. There were many other things that would tell you time, including your own mobile phone. So we realized that over time, watches were becoming more like fashion statements. If they were becoming more like fashion statements, one of the categories which was actually doing very well was actually fashion brands of watches. So when we saw a lot of fashion brands, in the initial months of brands like Esprit, etc., we realized that that's an opportunity that we have. Obviously, Titan and brands can never be fashion brands. So it can't be fashion brands. Can we actually go and license a few fashion brands and then take the license for India and then complement our regular brand of watches with licensed fashion brands? And like that, the first brand that we got is Tommy Hilfiger, and then of course we had others like Timberland, Police, French Connection, etc. You might not see any mention of Titan within there, but the fact is that Titan is the licensee for the brand, and Titan then makes it, assembles it, imports it, whichever way it looks at it, and then after that makes this whole range available and in the store. And these complement the Fast Tracks and the Sonatas and the Zyrus and the Titans and the Ragas, which are already available in the store. So what you suddenly see is that from about 6 or 7 own brands, your whole range has now gone to about 10 or 12 brands, and you're able to then start controlling a larger part of the watch market. Then along with this, we realize that it's just not about building brands. It's also about making sure that you, when you look at the value chain, you have brand and manufacturer at the one end, and you have retail and customer at the other end. And in between you have distribution, and then you have retail stores. So we said that, you know, there's no point in controlling distribution because distribution is a low margin business. So he said the other option to do is to start looking at retail. So So when you look at a watch, and if you look at retail margins, it's, you know, kind of between 15 to 20, 22% and after with some of the, you know, larger the larger chain department stores, the margins even go higher. What you do realize is off retail price, that is between 20 to 25%, which is going away. And on the other hand, when you look at it from a manufacturing margin perspective, you realize that as a manufacturer or the brand, you get less margin than you're getting as a retailer or a brand. So we said that maybe there is an opportunity for us to do retail on a large scale. So the first and the initial bit of retail was actually done in the case of what we called as the World of Titan. And the World of Titan was the first exclusive retail store. First one started in 1987. And then of course that gained Philip after 1990, because we did one store for about almost 1.5 years. And then learn, you know, lots of things about retail, you know, do people walk into the right, do people walk into the left, how long do they spend in terms of buying, etc. And then actually created a franchise model around it, and then built this franchise model out on a very large scale. And that's how the World of Titan came and grew. Tanishq, when we started, we realized that there is no way we can actually do, other than exclusive brand retail, there is no other form of retail. You cannot make jewelry and supply to another jeweler, because the designs will get copied within a couple of weeks of you supplying to them. So we said it has to be exclusive brand retail. So Tanishq always started as an exclusive brand retail, whether it's owned by the company or whether it's run by a franchisee. Similarly, Titan I Plus. Then of course, when other brands came in, like, you know, the licensed brand, and then FastTrack was gaining currency, and we felt that some of the younger customers might not like the seriousness of a Titan showroom, then we started creating FastTrack showrooms, which are much younger. Then we realized that when in a later part of the history, we realized that a lot of people actually are coming in, they probably know Titan, they know FastTrack, and a lot of other the Titan house brands. But the point is that they want to look at all these new brands which are coming in. So we then started another retail chain called Helios. And Helios is actually a chain which is actually controlled by Titan, but then it's got Titan watches and Titan branded owned and licensed watches, as well as a whole bunch of other competitive watches. And the whole is under one roof, which is called Helios, run and managed by Titan again. And then the other most important thing that we felt and that we started again way back in the mid-90s is that we said, the retail focus cannot be only at the point of sale. The point of sale is where you capture the customer. But the customer journey with you is over the lifetime of the product or the lifetime of the customer, whichever you look at it. But the point is that you cannot just deliver on an experience when they buy, you have to deliver on an experience even after they buy. So then we started revamping all the service centers and then created a new chain of service centers which were called watch care centers, where you would be greeted and treated exactly like the way you would be greeted and treated in a World of Titan showroom when you come to buy a watch. So classically what used to happen is that you buy a watch, you buy it in the front of the store, when you want to repair a watch, you'd be sent to come back and you meet with one service guy who doesn't understand what you're saying, etc., etc., and you finally feel that you're at the mercy of that service mechanic. Here we wanted to create that whole experience to make it very, very different from the way people were imagining service. And this is for all categories of products. And we invested in this way back in 94-95 in terms of building something called the Watch Care Center. So what we can see here is, again, it's not just about building brands, it's also about building retail. It's not just about retail only for the purpose of sale, it's also retail for the purposes of service. It's not just about your brands, but if there's an opportunity in the larger market, how do you capitalize on that? So some of the key learnings is that, you know, as you go along, you keep following the consumer. Keep understanding what is happening to the consumer, because if you don't keep following the consumer and you don't keep adapting your business model, then obviously you will be a business of history and not a business of the future. So that's one of the most important things. Second is, if you ask consumers what exactly do they want, most consumers are pretty clear about a few things. But if you expect that the consumer is going to envision your strategy, then many a time you discover that, you know, you're going to be either running against a blank wall or you'll go around the wrong path. So the key and most important thing is that how do you co-create with a customer? But as you co-create with a customer, you have to sometimes do things which the customer doesn't even tell you to do. But you must have the conviction that this is something which is going to be successful. Some of that will work and some of that might not work. But the point at the end of the day is that unless you try it out, you cannot change the market, and otherwise you'll only be following what others are doing. So that's the other most important thing in terms of not just anticipating, but also about creating needs. Third is about, you know, I mentioned about Helios and World of Titan and others. It's about becoming a market participant. participating in the retail of watches with your brands and with other people's brands, inasmuch as you're participating in the watch market with your brand. So I think there's, you know, two strategies there that we are following. Then build a powerful brand in extent. So build brands like Titan, which extended into eyewear. Build brands like Fast Track, which went after that into, you know, rucksacks and helmets and various other categories of products, etc. Build competencies which can extend into new businesses. So precision engineering was about engineering skills which then extended into automobile and the aircraft business. And then build lifetime customer value, because that's the most critical thing. You know, when a customer buys your product, that's the beginning of a relationship. So how do you then make sure that across the entire tenure of the relationship, you actually profit from it, in as much as the customer also profits from it. So this whole balance between experience versus profit is something that you've got to carefully balance when you realize how you build lifetime customer value. When I look at the Reliance retail story, and I know we are running a little short on time, again here, in the beginning, it was all about saying, what do we do? And because Reliance is a company which always thinks of businesses in a very different manner, initially when we were starting the business, one of the things Mr. Ambani said is that we don't have any joint venture partners. You know, we don't have any core competencies in this business. If we don't have a joint venture partner telling us what we should do, nor do we have competencies, core competencies in the business which tells us that we are very good at this kind of retail, he said then what should stop us from doing all kinds of retail? So why should we just focus only on one format? So initially, of course, when you look at it from a strategic perspective, you can actually say that, you know, if you look at the entire retail market, 45% of the retail market is food and grocery. Then, of course, if you look at all the others, they're all single-digit numbers. Jewelry is 6-7, apparel is about 8-9, electronics is about 7-8%. So logically, you look at actually addressing the food and grocery customer. So that's the largest part of the market, and that's the greatest opportunity in terms of doing retail. But his point is that let's do every retail. He says, what is it we learn? And of course, in Reliance, when you do pilots are not 10 stores, so then pilots are normally 100 stores. So typically, you do 100 store pilot, then you learn. And then the whole logic that he said is that anyway, if you put up 100 stores and you make some mistakes in these pilots, some 20, 30 stores you close. So close 20, 30 stores, some 60, 70 will work. And the balance which you close down, you at least learn what is needed to be doing for the next 100 stores that you have to do. So the whole thing was that the learning comes at a very fast pace. Of course, it also comes at a great cost. But the whole logic was that unless you go fast, you cannot learn fast enough. And there are many things that you will not learn unless you, you know, do start doing at scale. And then if you then the second whole logic was about how to crunch in terms of project time. So because Reliance is very, very good at project management, it used to, you know, we always prided itself on the fact that we set up a refinery in 5 years and the world sets it up in 8 years. We set up a polyethylene plant in 2 years and the world sets it up in 4 years. So this is the way Reliance normally looks at it. Because in a business where the first output, the first product coming out actually carries a profit in it, which is whether it's a refinery or whether it's a polyethylene plant, then the faster you set it up, the additional time that you get to make profit out of it. So the cost is always measured between, if I can save 90 days by airlifting something which will cost me, you know, so much, an airlifting equipment which will cost me so much, but in that 90 days, if I looked at the plant coming up 90 days earlier, but the EBITDA of that product is more than the cost of airlifting, airlift. You know, so that's the logic. It's very different. So when you look at it traditionally, everybody will say that you wipe the air, you didn't actually send it by sea, and you'll have a container and it'll take, you know, actually, you know, 1.5 months for it to come. So there's several stories, you know, how when they set up the refinery, they actually ship parts of the refinery from Korea to the Jamnagar, and in the process of shipping, the ship itself was designed in order to be able to assemble parts as it came around so that you could actually crunch in it. So that's the kind. So the whole thing about setting up stores was about how we set it up as fast as possible. Because if the store is profitable, then the faster you set it up, the more profitability you actually generate. So the thinking in retail was actually not so much retail, but about core project management skills. And about the fact that, first of all, don't be afraid to test all waters. Because anyway, unless you test, you won't know. The second part of it was that if you're doing something as a pilot, do it on a reasonably large scale so that you please learn, rather than do three and then keep conjecturing about what the other five could actually be. The third part of it is see how you can actually crunch all these project times such that you can actually start delivering on profits much faster. So, this is just a few of the pictures of the brands that Reliance, the formats that Reliance have on its own, which are actually under the Reliance branding. So there's Jewels, Trains, Fresh, etc. was there. And then in addition to that, we also said that, okay, fine, let's say for example, you look at the apparel industry. If you look at the ready-made garment industry, there are people consuming ready-made garments in different segments. So there are a bunch of people who consume luxury and premium. Then there are a bunch of people who want to buy, let's say, more premium mass. Then there are people who want to buy mass. So how do you then architect a business model which is enabling you to satisfy the garment consumption needs of India? So in that, you might decide that I will do mass on my own. I will do, let's say, premium mass with a brand like, say, Marks & Spencer, which was there as one of the joint ventures. I might actually look at a brand like Diesel and look at it being for the young. I might look at a brand like, say, Zenia and look at it for the luxury customer. So the whole concept around the joint ventures was to be able to, these are just a few of them, and totally there are actually 25 joint venture brands that Reliance has. But these brands are all brands which complement the businesses that Reliance itself is in. So except for food and grocery, where we realize that there is no merit in bringing an international brand in. But if you look at footwear, you have Footprint, and along with Footprint, you have ASICS and you have Taylor Shoe Source. If you look at the apparel industry, you have Trains, which is the main brand from the garment industry. And then, along with that, you have the joint venture with Marks & Spencer. And then you have a host of these brands, which are actually in the apparel space, largely the apparel and the accessory space. So this was, again, a very different model. Unlike Titan, where the whole model is about building your own brands and then using those brands to service the market, and then a few licensed brands to complement the area that you can't do yourself. In this particular case, it was about quick, rapid expansion and how to capture category consumption and thereby between your brands and other brands. Spent a lot of time and invested a lot of time, money, and in terms of technology was in ensuring that an integrated supply chain was built. So whether it's in terms of the vegetables that we had to source, getting down up to the farmer level, creating what we call as collection centers at the farmer, then being able to pay the farmer immediately so that there was an incentive for them to sell to you rather than go and sell it to the mandi, then bringing it to a processing plant, cleaning, grading it, processing it in some cases, storing it in some cases, moving it to distribution centers in the cities, moving it to smaller distribution centers in nearer to the stores, and then finally moving it to stores before it gets sold to the customer. So the journey that much of the vegetables that we sourced in this country went through. And as you can see, between the supply chain and the logistics part of it, there was a lot that you did, there's a lot that you had to depend on third parties to do. But that's the level of detail that you had to go through, even in a category like fruits and vegetables. And similarly, when you really look at it, it's a lot of detail that you have to put into several other categories. But the most complex that you have is actually in the fruits and vegetables space. Retail real estate is the other part. We all know that one of the key success factors of retail is about location, location, location. So if you've got to be in the right location, how do you ensure that you had? Because Reliance had a large number of formats, it had the opportunity to be able to go in and negotiate with malls and say that I'll take 150,000 or 200,000 square feet. And then divide it between its own formats, in the formats that it had joint ventures with, etc., and thereby build a pretty large model in terms of retail real estate, investing sometimes in pieces of land because, let's say, for example, in a city like Delhi, there was no land available. Consequently, all the people who were building malls on the outskirts. So they were building it in Gurgaon, they're building it in Faridabad, they're building it in Noida, but nobody's actually building a mall in Delhi, because there was no land available. So the only land which is available is government land. So we went in and bid for 9 parcels of government land way back in 2008 and then paid in those days 1200 crores for those 9 parcels of land and converted that into malls in order to be able to create shopping opportunities for the Delhi customer in Delhi rather than actually getting them to go across to Gurgaon, to Noida, to Faridabad to experience a mall. People, again, as you know, in retail, one of the key important ingredients is people, because at the end of the day, in retail, you're selling the same product that somebody else is selling. Because there's nothing new that you're doing, except the private label collection that you might have in apparel or jewelry or in footwear, which is maybe 30, 40, 50, 100% of your offering. But beyond that, all are brands which other people also sell. So then what do you deliver on? The only way you can deliver on is either you deliver on price, which is what the e-commerce people do, or you deliver on service, which is what most of the offline retailers are challenged to do. And when you have to deliver on service, who delivers on that service? Some part of it might be technology, but a large part of that is people. So there's a lot of investment in people in terms of what we call as hiring for attitude, training, attrition, and of course, the attrition is a huge challenge in retail. So how do you then make sure that you replace people who left the organization? So career growth, retention, training. So people was a very, very large focus area, because at one time we had about, at the time I left, we had about 32,000 people working in the stores. Processes and systems, you cannot do scale without processes. And I think this also comes from the fact that Mr. Ambani is an engineer, Mr. Modi is an engineer. So they also have a very engineering mindset when it comes to business. So when they look at it, they don't want anything which can be left loose. So a lot of it is about defining what will happen. So like you would run a chemical plant, exactly like that, a lot of processes are laid down so that it became very predictable. Of course, processes are both good and bad, because sometimes it takes out the delegation that you would normally like to do at the front end people, but nevertheless it acts as some kind of check and control. So over time we kind of built both the flexibility with the rigidity. So there were lots of things that we had to do. So whether it's in terms of how do you lay out a store, looking at some 23 different, you know, store formats and assortments for, let's say, just food and grocery, then trying to figure out which is the appropriate format for that particular location. And like that, you know, you start building around in terms of, you know, defining the layout, looking at what sells on each shelf, replanning shelf layouts in terms of based on what the sale is, etc. But the whole thing is that it's a very, very science and data-driven business, in as much as it's an art. So the art comes in terms of interacting with the customer, ensuring that you understand what the customer requires, being able to plan what you need to produce, what you need to keep in on your shelves. And then, of course, the whole science comes in terms of understanding what's sold out, how to be able to replenish that, what do you need to do in terms of system, what intelligence do you have about your customer, how do you target them, you know, with a degree of customization which makes sense. So it's a, you know, it's a blend of both that you have to look at it. IT, of course, had a whole bunch of systems, right from actually, you know, planning what you need to keep in the warehouse, in which area, to how we ship, let's say if you want to ship, you know, fruits and vegetables, and you want to ship it in, let's say, a city like Chennai, and you've got about 40 odd stores in Chennai. Some stores are one way, on one way street, some stores, trucks can't go in, so you have to send smaller loads. Some stores actually have a higher sellout. So let's say, for example, in the mango season, which is now, you might need to move 10 tons of mangoes into a store in some time. But how do you move 10 tons on auto rickshaws? So, you know, there's a whole transport planning mechanism based on each store where it is located. And that then is planned based on each season and the quantity of different kinds of fruits and vegetables which sell. And the peak challenge is invariably April to June when the mango season happens, because that's when bulk comes in. And in the fruits and vegetable business, bulk handling is often the biggest challenge, because neither do you have space at the back of the store to keep bulk, so which is why you have to frequently keep shipping it in. And then as you frequently ship it in, you realize that some places you can't ship in, you can only do it once in the, either in the night or very early in the morning. So along with the milk, you'll send in a lot of stuff, but then the store doesn't have enough place, so they'll be keeping it on racks outside the shop. And when customers come in, they'll see racks inside, racks outside. Halfway through the day, the racks outside then go inside, and because it then uses for replenishment. So lots of funny things happen, but the whole challenge is about making sure you understand what is required in the store. So when you really look at it, you know, consumers and industry change drivers, you know, consumers are constantly changing, where they buy from is changing, and where, what kind of products that they buy are also changing. So that's something that you have to truly keep, like, you know, following the moving consumer in the watch business is as critical in the retail business. The second part of it in terms of what are the kind of retail formats that you should be putting up, how different and distinct should they be. Third part was in terms of supply planning, we discussed that. How do you get your suppliers to also, you know, make sure that they are abreast of you, in as much as you are abreast of the customer. Because in the retail business, it's not just about you being abreast of the customer, but while you're abreast, your supplier will also have to understand how to be abreast. Demand planning, unified view, flow shortages, we discussed that in some detail. store operations in terms of just planning where you keep products. How do you define the science of keeping products in different parts of the store? IT and technology is a very, very critical element because none of this can be done manually. The moment you build scale, you'll just fall over if you try and do it manually. So there's a lot of technology use that you had to do in terms of just ensuring that you had information visibility and how do you use it smartly. Loyalty programs and other customer information to make it simple in terms of addressing the customer. So when you look at retail, you know, and when I see it over the years, what I've seen is I've seen retail in Titan in 87, 90. I've seen retail as we progressed in Titan across several of our business. I've seen retail in Reliance. But one of the key things that I've seen is that the use of technology in retail has actually only increased over time. It has not declined at all. And what is seemingly happening today is the fact that technology is one of the key drivers of retail. And if you have to be a smart retailer in the future, you have to ensure that you use technology, not just in terms of delivering products to the customer and keeping an understanding of the customer and a relationship with the customer, but also in the way you're actually running your internal businesses. So all of your internal store processes also have to be completely technology enabled, in as much as you create visibility for the customer. The other part that I wanted to just talk about was, Kumar had mentioned saying that just talk about the private equity stint. So I thought I'd add it in. I don't have a presentation on it. But primarily at this stage, one of the roles that I'm playing is actually on the strategy board of two private equity funds, to be honest. One is a fund which is called L. Catterton, which is a joint venture between the LVMH group, and they have one fund called L. Capital, which partnered with an American private equity fund called Catterton Partners, and there is an Asia fund based out of Singapore on whose strategy board I am. And I'm also on the strategy board of another fund which is run by Azim Premji, which is called Premji Invest, which is an India-focused fund. So while the Singapore one is an Asia-focused fund, the other one is an India-focused fund. The India-focused fund for Premji, I spend more time in the consumer segment, which is different from the other businesses. And in the case of the Singapore fund, what I do spend time on is I spend time on consumer and retail across Asia. But one of the things that I've seen is that we invest monies in companies which are in India, for example, typically between about 300 to about 600 crores in terms of revenue. And when you really look at these companies, you know, these are businesses that have been built over time. Some of them have taken 10, 12 years. Some have actually taken a lifetime to build. Then for a variety of reasons, they've realized that they've hit some kind of a cap. And when I look at a cap, it might be sometimes, and a lot of these caps are actually mental, in the sense that these are caps that have been driven by their own thinking about what they can do. Sometimes a lot of these businesses have grown to accommodate one, two, sometimes even a third generation of people from the family who are involved in these businesses. So what does happen there is that some of the key roles are actually played by some of the key family members. Now, whether the family member is suitable or not suitable, of course, is a different question, but they occupy sometimes key roles. So that's another profile that we see in these businesses. Third is that a lot of them have actually struggled sometimes in balancing between brand and retail. And you know, sometimes there's an excessive focus on the brand, or sometimes there's an excessive focus on retail. And because of that, you need to create the right balance between the two. But what I've seen in a lot of businesses, and the most successful ones, are people who've actually first figured out that they can't do this themselves. Neither can their family do this themselves. So they've actually gone about to be able to build a professional organization. When I say professional organization, I'm not talking about hiring people for the sake of hiring. But this is about hiring people for capability. Them having recognized that I have a limitation in this area. Because I have a limitation in this area, I need to get somebody who can support me. But when they bring in somebody to support them, the most smarter ones are the ones who are able to bring in people who actually are as entrepreneurial in thinking as they are, as opposed to being managerial in terms of thinking. And you know, I don't want to use this as an example in public, but I have seen some of the larger companies tend to give you very good quality material, but sometimes they tend to be very, very managerial, very focused. And when you look at a smaller business, it's about the fact that you have to expand your role. Your role is this as defined, But in reality, a role is much wider than what is defined. So how do you then bring people who have that thinking, saying that I'm not just a general manager operations, but I'm a general manager for this company, which might involve operations today, might involve supply chain tomorrow, might involve finance day after tomorrow, but I must have the thinking which allows me to be able to do that rather than being narrow-minded. So one of the key success factors I've noticed is people who manage to build capable organizations, which is a mix of both family as well as people from outside. The second thing that I've seen is that what capability lies in the organization sometimes is very good for a 50 crore organization. But that same capability, organizational capability, when you go to 100 crore, requires that you have to build another skill set. That skill set means sometimes you have to reconstruct the organization, certainly. You have to sometimes shed some people because you realize that they don't have the capability. So you have to shed some people, get in some new people. So there are those challenges which are there. And some of the smarter ones are the ones who've understood that well enough and then manage to morph their organizations as they are growing, not having too much dependence on the people who brought them to where they are. Third is that when you really look at it, from being a startup to accelerating, there are different skill sets which are required. And I've seen this in both Reliance and in Titan. You might call both of them as startups when they started. It might have been large startups with large investments, but nevertheless startups. But there are a bunch of people who can do excellently when you start up the organization. They've got the passion, they've got the energy, they're able to do many things, they're able to build it up. But the moment the organization starts growing larger, then you have to define it a little more in a more structured manner. When you have to start laying down some processes, some of these people find it to be a bit of a misfit. People are a misfit and their attitude is also a bit of a misfit. So you then have to start bringing in people who can actually, one group built the ship, but you need another group to actually sail the ship. So I think that's the other part that you also have to remember as to how do you develop organizational capability as you grow along, because there are different skill sets required at different stages in the growth of an organization. The other part is about the fact that, you know, finance obviously is the key part of driving growth, and it's all about managing the whole balance between equity and debt, making sure that you don't give away too much equity in the beginning, because that is quite pointless. How do you actually fund the growth using a judicious combination of equity and debt? How do you ensure that the debt load is not going to be so much on your organization that you'll actually sink under the load of the debt? So you have to figure out that entire balance, appropriate level, who are the people that you will bring in, along with the money, what kind of skill sets that you also want to bring in. So there is a big balance that you have to actually bring about between this whole equity debt structure. So it's not about just going in and raising money. It's about raising money at the right time. It's about making sure that you raise the appropriate amount of money. Because there are a lot of people who come in and say, oh, you need only 50 crores, but I can give you 100 crores. And if you're a greedy type, you might say, well, give me the 100 crores. But in the process of getting more money than what you need, you do a lot of silly things also. So the important thing is, how do you just get enough money that is required for that stage of growth in your business and build value so that the next time when you require the additional 50 crores, it's not going to come at the cost of your ownership. So if you parted with 10% for the first 50 crores, the next 50 crores you might only part with 5%. But instead, if you took 100 crores immediately, instead of parting with 10%, you've already parted with 20% at that stage for money that you never ever required, but will sit in a bank and earn you FD interest. Or you might, because you've got the money, do something silly and burn it away pretty soon. So, you know, that whole thing of being able to balance between the two is also very critical. The other thing is that, you know, a lot of us actually as promoters, startup evangelists, etc., we build it to a certain level. But we realize that as we grow larger and larger, the dimensions which the business acquires actually changes. Suddenly finance becomes a lot more critical. You open up a retail chain, then some, you know, HR becomes critical. So there are things that you never really bother too much about. Suddenly they assume new dimensions in terms of importance to your organization as you're growing. So as you grow along, you also have to recognize that, you know, I'm only good at this. And some of the smartest promoters I've seen are people who are very clear that I'm good at this. And for anything else, I will actually look outside. I don't want to believe that I'm good at all of these things and then make a mess of it. So that's also another very important thing, which requires, you know, swallowing some ego, recognition of your own capabilities, you know, not letting your success go to your head, saying that, you know, I got it from 0 to 20 crores very well, So because of that, I can also get it from 20 to 100 crores very well. So sometimes, you know, there is a difference between getting it from 20 to 100. So those are some aspects that I just thought I'll share with you, because a lot of you all are actually promoters, owners of businesses, etc. But as in you, when you look at your, you know, the path of growth, you do realize that, you know, you will be coming across many of these things. It is not an admission of failure. It is not the fact that, you know, if you are getting somebody else to come in to fund your business through equity, it's not because of the fact that you don't have money. The fact is that you want to grow this business much larger than what your current capability is. And any more if you take in terms of debt will endanger the business. So can I take it in the form of equity? So there are various ways we should actually look at it when you actually, you know, figure out how to construct it, how to be able to grow it, and how to scale it to a level, and then how to build it as a lasting business. And one of the things I've seen with some of the promoters is that at which stage do I move from being a promoter to a shareholder? Where I have the confidence that today I've built an organization which has got capability, and I can do other things and let the organization run its own rather than me running the organization all the time. And that is when the ultimate happens in terms of the transition from just being promoter to shareholder. So there are several steps in this journey and challenges that will come to you at different steps of the way. But I'm sure that, you know, when you look at it, every step is actually an enjoyable step, and every step will bring to you new challenges and new learnings. And I'm sure all of you have the capability to do well beyond. So I just thought I'd do a quick one, maybe 5 minutes on what I think of India happening when you look at, let's say, the next 7 to 8 years. As you can see, you know, we'll be much larger as a population, we'll be much larger in terms of cities. So when you talk about larger population, same land mass, what it does mean is that the density will only increase of population. If you look at, let's say today we are a 35% urban contribution, if by 2027, 10 years from now, we become a 50% urban contribution, look at what will happen to our cities if there are double the size of the urban population as we have today. As it is today, it's in the challenge with between water and electricity and drainage and, you know, garbage and everything else. So there is huge. Now, when you look at that, there are, you know, on the one hand, we can say that if we do it the way we do it today, obviously we'll be some. But obviously there'll be new and interesting ways to do it. In that whole process of doing it differently, are there opportunities that we can see in terms of doing it in terms of a business? So does garbage suddenly become an opportunity as a business? Does renewable energy suddenly become an opportunity as a business? Are there ways in which, you know, I can look at several of these growth opportunities in urbanization as being opportunities for each of us in terms of business? Lots of, you know, developments in terms of, you know, telephone connection, cars, retail market. So if you look at cars, and you know, look at the number of cars that will come out into the roads over the next 7-8 years, the number will be much, much larger than what we itself know today, what kind of challenges we have in terms of jams, etc. So the same set of roads remain, what will happen? What does it mean? Volatility is the name of the game. There is one of the other things that we, when I say volatility, it's about the rate of change. And the rate of change is just suddenly increasing higher in terms of frequency and shorter in terms of time span. So even if you look at your phone today, which has between 4 to 8 gigabyte of RAM, a laptop it had between 4 to 8 gigabyte of RAM about 3 years back. So what phones do today is what a laptop could do 3 years back. So which does mean that over time, you will find that there are newer and newer ways of doing things. One of the realities is that there are more mobile phones and smartphones being sold, and there are less laptops being sold, and that's a reality which will happen over time. New world order, we can actually see between the East and the West, there are obviously changes in terms of power. So China and parts of Asia are now gathering more strength and power, which is why if Trump says, you know, I'm going to be banning imports from China, China really doesn't bother about it. 10 years back, China would have been worried if Trump said that. Because China knows that Trump is as dependent on them as they are dependent on America, and it's a balance that has been built up, so it's very difficult to break it by any kind of bravado. New channels of product sales and service. Who imagined that 10 years back that we would actually have people buying products online like the way we had today? So two Bunsen boys came in and changed the entire way we would actually buy products. We all thought that we would be comfortable selling from stores and selling, you know, to people who will be standing in front, and we'll be the only ones who'll sell. But between the availability of information because of internet and the availability of channels in terms of e-commerce, today the whole balance of power has gone to the customer. So at one time we would advise the customer what is to be bought. Today the customer is advising us as retailer, saying what we should sell. So at what prices we should be selling it at. So that whole balance itself changed because of some of the new channels of products. New payment mechanisms, you can see whether it's digital wallets, credit cards, debit cards, whichever form you look at it, mobile, EDC machines, all of that. New delivery methods, we heard about Amazon experimenting with drones, so who knows, but drones might become a reality. Today they use currently only to carry cameras in taking pictures. But if it can carry a camera and take a picture, it can do a lot more things in terms of security. If it can go up, it can do a lot more things in terms of delivery. So there are a lot of things that can actually happen in terms of drones and new transportation systems. So when you really look at it, one of the things we should remember is that machines will slowly steal your jobs. So anything which is routine, anything which is standard, will actually be stolen because there is a predictability about it. So when we talk about technologies like artificial intelligence, machine learning and stuff like that, there are many things that can be done which actually might be able to be, can be used in order to change the way you might do business. I know that Girish is actually speaking after me and he certainly will focus on this part in terms of technology. So I won't take too much time, but there are things that are happening, emotional artificial intelligence, which means that it's just not about understanding what people predictably to do, but also understanding the tone of voice. So if I can get to understand the tone of voice through a machine, like say an Alexa, and if I express it in a manner which the machine understands, and then Alexa will also understand that there's an anxiety factor in addition to the voice. So the moment I layer the two together, then obviously the response can be very different from the way I would just respond to the speech by itself. 5G networks, which means that the amount of data carried is much higher. Medical diagnostics, several things can be done by machines which otherwise had to be done by a nurse. We all talk about autonomous cars and Google self-drive car, etc. But that can actually become a reality over time. 3D printing cheap enough to print clothes at homes. Currently, it's printing a lot of parts today, which can allow you to be able to, so one-off for those who have vintage cars, many of those parts not being available are currently 3D machine printed, so that you can build the same part out and not have to leave your car on the side. Robots understand speech. Work as a receptionist. Think of the implications it has in restaurants, in hotels, in clinics. And imagine also if it were to come into a store. If I can guide a customer without having to really worry about having a person worrying about attrition and training. One-time training and upload software which will create a patch and the robot will be actually trained very well. Renewable energy will be cheaper. In fact, the reality is it is cheaper. Today at 2.69 rupees was the last solar power auction that went off. So at some stage it'll start coming down in terms of cost. So it'll be cheaper than actually buying grid power. Then if you look at it in terms of drone flights, and drones are getting cheaper, and I kind of imagine a scenario where up to 100 feet you would only be allowed to go by cars. And then from 100 feet to 1,000 feet you can have drones which will be using that part of the airspace, which means that a lot of mobility will actually happen. And above 1,000 feet it might be for helicopters, and beyond a certain level for aircraft. But if you actually start segmenting the atmosphere in that manner, then you can create. What have we done? We've just built roads and we've got cars running on roads. And then after that, we have aircraft in them. We've never done anything smart between the aircraft and the car. So imagine if we were to start segmenting and using all of that space, like the way we segment the ground and start using that. Then there's a lot more that you can actually do with drones. And 50% of all vehicles, of course that trend is actually happening in terms of electric vehicles. So there are lots of things like this which we have to really worry about. Now, virtual reality today is getting to a level where people can imagine how they look like in those clothes. If you take that one step ahead and say that if you imagine how you look like if you were standing in front of the Taj Mahal, imagine what it will do to the travel industry. Why would people want to go there? So it will have to be not just to see a place, but for the experience. And if you have to go for the experience, then the whole way you market travel will also have to be very different. So I'm just saying that new players which are coming in, the moment technology starts changing these. So many more such things, but I think we'll need a lot more time to cover all of that. So thank you very much. I've taken a lot longer than what I intended to.